Salutations, celestial sightseers. I'm David Fuller. Welcome to Eyes on the Sky. What's up this week? We continue the parade of planets. And if we look into the evening sky in very late October, early November, we can see that we have Saturn and Mars. And we talked about Neptune a couple weeks ago about how to find that planet. And Uranus, the seventh planet, is the last one kind of in our parade there. And it actually reached opposition on the 23rd of October. So if we just kind of bump ahead, even just a little bit, 1 hour to 7 o'clock, you can see how it's already up in the evening sky. Better time to see it was probably going to be 8 or 9 o'clock, since it's quite a bit higher, gets it kind of out of the muck of the atmosphere. And especially if you have light pollution, that's going to make it even harder to find. But the good thing about Uranus compared to Neptune is that it's 2 magnitudes brighter. So instead of being 8th magnitude, we're looking at a 6th magnitude object. So much simpler to try to find and see. So let's turn on some of our constellation markers so we can see kind of the part of the sky that we're in. Notice that Uranus is actually in the constellation of Pisces. Pisces is ridiculously faint as far as constellations go. It largely has 4th and 5th magnitude stars, making it difficult to use it as a guide specifically. And even Cetus down below there doesn't have a lot of bright stars. However, we are fortunate in that if we look where Andromeda and Pegasus are, down below there, we've got Aries. And Aries has a couple nice bright stars in it. Hamal, Alpha Arietis, is a 2nd magnitude star. And then if we go over to Sheraton, Beta Arietis, that's a 2.6 magnitude star. So those should be visible to just about everybody at naked eye. So therefore, you're going to want to start with binoculars or a magnified finder scope and aim at Aries. Because if we zoom in just a little bit, we can see how we've got these two stars right here and not a lot else kind of around there. What I am going to do to manipulate Stellarium just a little bit to kind of make some of these things a little bit easier to see is we're going to kind of change our absolute scale and relative scale just a bit to make some of these brighter stars that are there actually look a little brighter, because there's some important shapes for you to be able to find when you're looking for this. So let's begin at Hamal and Sheraton. If we kind of split that difference and go to a binocular field of view, you can see how in 7x50 binoculars with a 7-degree field, which a lot of finder scopes will do the same, we've got Hamal and Sheraton right in our field. Now with binoculars, we're going to get a correct image up, down, left, right field of view. These will be reversed if you're looking through most finder scopes. So this star over here by Sheraton is kind of the one that's going to help us, because we're going to use Sheraton and Masarthim as our guide stars to get us going. Now, the problem is that Uranus is actually further than 7 degrees away from Masarthim. So we have to sort of use our ability to just have faith that we're going to get there if we follow this general line. Because if I back out of this, and I'm going to show you using the measuring tool, you can see how if we go towards Uranus, that's pretty close to that line. Even if we follow that line exactly, we can see how we're really only a degree away off of it. So if we've got a 7-degree field of view, we're going to get to where Uranus is at without too much difficulty. So if we zoom back in using that field of view, and we go this direction like that, see how we've got now Sheraton's out of the way, Masarthim's almost out of the way. And if we scoot this direction and keep going, oh look, see, there's Uranus. But you may not be sure that you're actually finding it. So what you're gonna see most likely first is this star in Pisces, which is Omicron Piscium. I don't know how to say that with the correct pronunciation, so I'm not going to try. So Omicron Piscium is definitely what we're looking for. Now, when you get to there and go, oh, hey, nice 4th magnitude star, now look back towards these stars, because this one is a 6th magnitude star. This one just below Uranus is a 7th magnitude star, and Uranus itself is 6th magnitude. So you're going to go 6, 6, 7. Now, The way to be able to find that for sure is I looked for and found pretty easily, because I couldn't see the rest of these stars. All I could see was this star, so HIP 8588, Uranus, and then this one, HIP 8859. And then I was able to see this triangle of stars, 9295, which is a sixth magnitude star, this one, which is seventh, and then this one, which is sixth again. So a number of sixth magnitude objects. You got four of them there, and then two seventh magnitude objects that form some really flat triangles. And once you find this larger one, look for this one at a little bit more than a 90 degree angle to it. And Uranus is going to be the apex of that particular triangle. And if you look for Omicron, Piscium, and you'll be able to see all of those in that 7 degree field of view if you've got Uranus centered in there. And that's how you'll definitely be able to find the seventh planet. Cool fact about Uranus is that it doesn't orbit on its axis like Earth does, or a lot of the other planets where they're mostly upright. Uranus kind of actually rotates on its side like this and sort of rolls along. So it has a very odd tipped rotation, I should say, not its orbit, but its rotation of the planet itself as it orbits around the sun. It is also pretty far from us. We can look for the distance from us, which is 18.82 astronomical units. That works out to about 2.5 or 3 hours of time that it takes that light to bounce off of Uranus and come all the way back to us. Uranus also, much like Neptune was, does not really look star-like, particularly as you put some magnification on it with a telescope. So the more magnification that you use, the less star-like it's going to look, the more it's just going to kind of sit there and be nice and steady for you. It won't twinkle at all like a star does. And you will actually get a little tiny bit more disk because its apparent diameter is almost 4 arc seconds across. So that's almost a full arc second more. That's just more than a full arc second more than Neptune was, which was really tiny at 2.3. So at 3.74, you've got almost 4 arc seconds. That's about the size that Mars gets, kind of at its furthest and smallest distance from us. And it will not move a whole lot over the course of time. And then if we look forward in the months ahead, it doesn't move a whole lot. It kind of stays right there near that star. If we go back, it was further away, but it's sort of sitting right there for at least the next several months. That's all for this week. Keep your eyes on the sky and your outdoor lights aimed down so we can all see what's up. I'm David Fuller, wishing you clear and dark skies.